The idea is today we're going to be looking at setting up a pose in a program called DAZ3D. It's just a nice, simple way to quickly pose a character to use as reference if you need to save time and if you don't have the time to kind of set up your own pose. It's a very helpful program in that case, just to get started and get everything anatomically correct in perspective to save you time. It's always good, of course, to make sure that you're practicing life drawing and are good at that, so you don't need to depend on a program necessarily. But we'll get into it and look at how to quickly use that. So that's DAZ Studio from DAZ3D. So we'll just switch over to the old Cintiq to take a look at that here. I should get my camera going on. So, I mean, this is what it looks like without going too far into everything that DAZ can do. You can download some of their models, female and male. These are the Genesis 8. They're free. The program is free. You just have to sign in register a sign in with that. So yeah, we just go into our figure section underneath the products, and I click on that, and that there's anything that I've downloaded in there. You can see that there's lots of products available. That's kind of how DAZ makes their money, is they will sell, you know, textures, skins, poses, animations, everything on there for these characters, and a lot of people use this program. There are others out there, but use this program to set up some of their scenes, and sometimes they just render out their these characters that they build out of all the assets to make their own art. So for us though, we're just going to keep it simple. We're just going to load the female here, the dev load female, and so we have her there. So you can use this to orbit in the upper right hand corner here, to orbit around or to move to different projections of the body in there. So we would load this up, and of course she feels very wooden right now. If I'm going to be building a zombie, I would want a pose that is more indicative of a zombie, kind of with the contortions and the kind of torment, I guess you would see in a zombie body. So I can get in there and start clicking on different parts of her body to start moving that around. I can also go back into the products section and click on poses. You can see that they have some ready-made poses already kind of loaded up in there. This is also something that you can go and buy more poses. For me, I don't know if I would spend money on poses, because we can just easily pose things in here. But you can get started with a basic pose to maybe work from if you want to save some more time. Right. So for her, maybe we've get a little bit of a walking pose. Got one pose here, walking A. She's got her hands up in a peace sign, not really useful. So I might just double click that one and it loads the pose onto the model. So we see she's planting her foot forward and walking. So that might be something that we can start with at the very least. You could always start with the base pose as well in there. So you know, this is the fun part. So we start to kind of, you see that wherever I mouse over on the body, you see kind of the isolation of those body parts, right? So if I wanted to start kind of getting some counterposing or contrapposto going in her body, I can maybe start clicking on the midsection, and you can grab the rotation tools in here. Those are the little rings. You can see red, blue, and green, different axis of rotation. So I can kind of turn her body around like this, or rotate towards the obliques, and then kind of bend her forward and backwards, right? So I might have her, really at this point it's kind of about experimentation. So one pose that might look good is her kind of leaning forward. Just, I would make sure that it looks like she can catch her own weight and not feel like she's going to tip over. I mean, the imbalance in a zombie is going to be huge, but of course a zombie still needs to be upright if they're walking, right? So there still has to be balance within the complete pose, but the way the body is trying to keep itself up should look labored and contorted even, right? To sell sort of the kind of dead qualities of this reanimated person, right? You don't want them to look like they're just kind of walking to work like a normal living human, right? You want it to feel a little bit more like it is a well, a zombie. So we could have her leaning forward, or we could have her leaning back, trying to kind of get her movement straight. Overall, you should have an idea in your mind of like a vision of what you want. The nice thing about this is you can play with a few different versions of your model, and then you can you know, just print screen, even screen capture, and just drop that into Photoshop at any point to build your different poses. I might try and go for something that is maybe she's leaning back a little bit. If that were the case, I'd maybe want to kind of tilt that head forward, maybe even the neck to try and make it feel like she's counterbalancing that energy that's going over her back there. So even then, it starts to almost feel like this kind of zombie skulking towards you, right? Trying to keep its balance, right? So something like that looks pretty good. The hips and the shoulder axis are fairly close. We have one shoulder, her right shoulder, kind of tilting up a little bit. I might embellish that a bit more. So like I mentioned before, we can get into these different sections of her body and start kind of tilting them a little bit more. So I might have that tilt that way. Maybe we can kind of bring, maybe we tilt it even a little bit more. That might be pretty cool. And we can see how this will feel once we start tilting that part of her body back upwards and get into the neck. Maybe we start to counteract that way to move her head back towards the center line of her body, just to make sure that that weight is all kind of sitting over that foot. You can see here where it's going to be pretty precarious for her to keep her balance, because a lot of this mass is starting to, it is positioned over that planted foot, but it is starting to kind of lean out over that. And of course, it's at some point going to feel like she's going to fall over, right? So you just want to make sure that whatever you're doing with that, that it kind of works in that balance sense. Still, you can be on the edge of that, and it might be really nice for this character to be on the edge of looking like they tip over, because a zombie will be, I mean, you could probably, if zombies were real, you would likely be able to push one over fairly easily, right? Because of the, typically in the story, they're bumbling and slow, unless you're thinking about something like 28 Days Later, where they're like the fury zombies, where they can climb stuff and run at top speed, right? So that said, you know, we've got that going on, that look right now. I might kind of rotate that neck back a little bit, so we just get that sort of interesting rhythm through her body. So there's a really nice gesture running up the outside of the leg through the body, and then this kind of like S curve that cuts through there. So I mean, we can rough that out for now. That feels pretty good. The nice thing about this is you can click the head and you can come over here into posing. And with that head selected, you can click this, the kind of parent bone here, and it will give you a list of options to pose, everything from the cheek creases for smiling, opening the mouth, opening the eyes, dropping the eyelid, everything like that in here. So we look down, we can start to see, you know, we can get her looking angry. And that might be easier to see if we zoom in a little bit on her face, right? So we can get her looking angry. We can get the jaw moving side to side, which might be nice. Maybe like the zombie has a broken jaw from all the chaos that's happened when they were turned into a zombie. Underbite, overbite, which might be pretty cool for a zombie as well. I might kind of give her a little bit of a... I mean, an underbite might be kind of cool, because it might help that feel of that kind of broken jaw vibe. We probably don't want her to smile, right? Unless it's some... It always depends on the context of your storytelling, right? So if you're building a story where your zombies are like these crazed look, like almost like the Joker, right, from Batman, then, you know, you could certainly do that. It'll always depend on what kind of look you want. So I kind of like that mouth open that surprised gives us. I could still work with that. I mean, there's not so much detail in the face with the eyebrows and whatnot that we couldn't just make it look like she's kind of, you know, that broken jaw is hanging down and they're kind of just looking out with that crazy look from there. I like the fact that the eyes are open. I might go to the eyelids, and I might close one of them to make it look like maybe one of them starting to or is infected or something like that, or that she's just kind of wincing. Her right, we might close that one and have that be something like that. That might look pretty cool in there. The brow, maybe we deal with the brow on her left side. So go and find the slider for the brow left. Brow up, down, left. So actually pulling it down kind of makes her look angry, which is kind of nice. So zooming out, you can just click off of the model to see it and use some of your pan, rotate. All of those tools are up in here. You just can kind of click and drag on that. Just see what she looks like right now. I don't know, feels not bad. I envision maybe in the spirit of something like a game like The Last of Us that's coming out soon here, I might have some sort of fungal growths or something coming out of her body. And so opening up that side might be a nice place to do that, right? So we have sort of the gesture running up through her body, and then it could even just exit out through some of this blooming of these kind of, I don't know, mushrooms or whatever, like fungi. So that's going to be nice for us there. This front arm is a counterbalance for her to be able to kind of, you know, skulk forward and be able to stay upright. So I feel pretty good about that. I might get into posing the hand a little bit. The other arm in behind her is a little bit weak. It's kind of also her thumbs clipping into her arm. And when I do decide to take a screenshot of her finally, I want it to be something that is visible, especially if you're doing a character design for asset production. You want to stay away from posing that's so dramatic where you get a lot of foreshortening or anything like that, because it's hard to actually read the information. So if you had modelers that needed to take that information and go and model, say in ZBrush, what it is you're after, and they can't see anything because you got a hand punching towards the camera and it covers up the rest of the body, for instance, right? That's kind of polar opposite end of bad posing for asset production, but you can see how that might be difficult for somebody to read, right? So we want to stay away from that if we can, and make it as clear as possible. If you're doing an illustration where, you know, a character's climbing over a fence and the zombies are down below them and trying to climb up after them, then of course you're going to be able to work more with dramatic posing and foreshortening and that kind of thing. Even in that case, you would want to make that a little bit more clear. So even just moving her arm back, being able to see it is better, right? For us to not be hiding that hand. Something I see a lot in novice artwork is people put hands in pockets or behind backs. It's obvious what you're doing there, right? You're hiding the hands because it's hard to draw typically. And they are hard to draw. They're very complex forms, right? That people are very critical about in artwork, and that can kind of lead to you know, people kind of switching off and your art or just moving along if they're not convinced. So very important to make sure that that stuff's correct. Benefit of something like Daz is that we don't have to you know, be pained with that, so to speak. But again, of course, you need to be practicing those things so you can do it on your own in case Daz does not load. So yeah, I mean, maybe dropping that arm behind is fine. I always like to give some dynamism of a sort to a pose, so it doesn't look wooden, or we don't get these very kind of straight lines that maybe speak to the edge of the frame, and we start to feel a rigidity overall in the composition, even in an asset production piece. So right now her arm's not bad, but I feel like we could even just have that maybe rotate out a little bit. So I'm gonna see if I can just have that bend a little bit, swing up into that arm. We could always try and rotate this outward a bit. Not bad. I might kind of bring that forward a hair and then rotate that outwards a little bit. So we're kind of accentuating the binding of her left side, our right, with that same shape in there, which might be nice. At that point, I could raise that arm a little bit, and then I might drop this wrist inward, right, to make it look kind of like contorted. You know, I start to think about the interesting shapes that we can make with our hands to make it look like we're, you know, if you were in pain all of a sudden, right, that torturous kind of look in the design, that might be something that we can do. If it's all just kind of rigid and straight, like I have my hand in the camera now, it might just look mannequin-like, right? Dead. Well, not dead in the good way, kind of vacant and wooden. So I like to move those things around to maybe make them feel more contorted. And so maybe I'll bend the wrist a little bit in there. If you ever have trouble kind of getting past some of these handles, you can always just click off different parts of the body so you can grab the hand again. So I'm going to go into the hand, back into our posing tab on the right hand side here, and click that top bone in there that says left hand. And that will give us some blend shapes that have already been created where we can play with that. So the fingers we can move them outward, inward in a grasp. You can make a fist out of the hand. I don't feel like my zombie's going to be clutching their hand in a fist. I might look for something that is more of a claw, right? So I might spread those fingers out a little bit and, you know, let's see if we can find something. You can kind of always bend the fingers individually, which might be nice. I might kind of go for the opposite of grasp here, just because I want those fingers to move outward, and then I can kind of zoom in there. And I might start bending those fingers independently with the transform tools in there to make it feel like we're getting that claw that I want. So rotate this one down a little bit more. We'll get even closer in there so we can grab those a little bit easier. And this is nice because there's a lot of experimentation opportunity to see kind of like what that could look like. Maybe we'll turn this one in a little bit as well. Rotate that out. And even rotate that one out a little bit more. You can hit certain points where it looks broken, so just be aware of that, right? So let's take a look at how that's looking right now. So that's pretty fun. Click off and we see that hand. If I want to open that up a little bit more, turn that pronate or supinate that hand so I can see the shape better, you know, I have that option. So I can go in there and kind of rotate that. It will run into the limits of moving a hand if your wrist is still, like how much flex does your hand actually have? So if I feel like I'm running into that limitation on the hand, then I would move to the forearm, right, to rotate that. So let's go and take a look at that. And you can see I get a lot more kind of movement out of that. So I could open the hand up this way to make it maybe look like she's gonna claw you, or if it feels better to move it the other way. we could try it that way, where she's kind of got her hand facing downward. Which, I mean, I kind of like the shape of it either way. I might keep it in that position so we get a kind of strong read on the kind of the claw of her fingers and then her thumb being kind of stuck out there. I can always change it later, right? So let us keep going here. So we can go back up to that top hand, or sorry, that that bone in the posing window to kind of get that same thing going on. Do I want to bend that wrist is the question at that point. Maybe. I mean, do I want both wrists to be bent downward? Or do I want them to kind of open up a little bit? If I opened her hand a lot, it might look a little bit strange. I feel like the limp wrist with the claw feels a little bit more like gravity's taking over on the zombie, where the life is kind of faded from them. So that might be a little bit better for me. Grasp fingers in and out. Right hand. Finger bend. I feel like I almost might go with the claw again on this hand, just to make it look like she's responding maybe to want to eat the protagonist, right? So they, you know, whatever sort of thought process is going on in a zombie's head is maybe triggered at that moment, that animalistic sort of claw sense that they're going to attack, right? So instead of kind of just having these, like, you know, almost like a dancer's fingers, like kind of flaring out, I would go back in with that look. So we might be able to kind of just more easily get to that point by going with grasp this time, and then just going independently and rotating those fingers outward. Seems like a better call. And we'll get this hand. Sometimes it's just trying to find the right handle to rotate these. That thumb out this way, rotate that to its maximum, and then rotate that thumb inward so we get that kind of claw look. All right, so start to kind of move that camera around to a place where that feels pretty good. I'm keeping an eye on this back foot. I don't want that back foot to kind of disappear in behind. It would be fine, I suppose, if it did disappear. But the nice thing about actually seeing it is we get to see where the other foot was planted, right? And get a sense of that space a little bit more. So I kind of want it a little bit more towards the camera because I want to project a little bit of the side of her body, but to see like what the zombie would look like coming towards the camera, which we typically see. That'd probably be the one view that we would see a lot. Is a zombie coming toward camera, right? So that's going to be kind of the key pose that we would want to nail. So if we're going to be putting forward an idea for design, we don't want to be posing the character in a way that A, which we already talked about, is difficult to read, but also B, is typical of what you would see when you first encounter said character creature, right? So something like this feels pretty good. I might move that camera up a little bit so the horizon line's closer to the top portion of the body, just so we don't get tons of distortion and make it look like we're kind of looking up at the zombie. Because again, that's a bit more dramatic and not necessarily super useful for a modeler, say. I'm gonna get something up in there. I tend to, when I'm doing character designs, put that line somewhere in the armpit region, shoulder height-ish for a character. So that feels pretty good to me. Somewhere in there, we'll go with it for now. And I mean, she's very shiny right now. The material that's been applied to her on the surface So you just go into surfacing, click your model, which will be under the Genesis 8 female for us. And we can just pull down this glossy layered weight slider to kind of take a little bit of bite out of the specularity that's kind of projecting onto her body. There's just a general sort of scene light in here that no matter where you put the camera, the light's coming from the camera direction. So you're getting the reflection off of it that way. Not super useful for what I need it for. I could set up, you can set up lights and cameras within DAZ and kind of really make it a good reference for that kind of thing. We're not going to get into that today. I'm just going to use this as a simple posing tool, which I tend to use it for most often anyway, right? But you do have the option of kind of really diving in to the sort of 3D camera lighting aspect that it does offer. So somewhere in there feels good. I'm not getting too distracted by the specularity and the body, and we get a good kind of look for her in there. Get to read the hands, the arms, the pose fairly well. I'm pretty happy with it at that point. So I'm going to use something like Windows Snip and Sketch, keeping it really low tech here just to get on with it, right? And so I've copied that and I can go in to Photoshop now. So I'm just going to load Photoshop and we will get that going on here, and then I'm going to transfer it over into Photoshop, and it's always good to save it as well. I'm just going to save it as a reference file. So if for whatever reason I start sketching, I don't like one aspect of it that I didn't kind of clue into before, I can always go back in there and kind of just move it around. Might as well, right? It's not going to take up too much room on your computer, and then you always have it for future reference. So pose zombie. All right, and I'm just going to close DAZ there. You guys aren't seeing that, but I will share now my Photoshop file. So I'm going to start a new file. I'm going to start something fairly big here. I tend to like to stay away from small files because you don't get too much fidelity when you zoom in, obviously. And B, when you're making stuff for other people to look at, especially like art directors, they're going to be looking at it usually on a larger screen. So you don't want to be making something small that they have to up-res on their screen and then it looks terrible, right? So, you know, sort of like a 4K would be the minimum I would work with. I'm just going to throw it into a general kind of larger file here. And I can copy that, and then I can paste that in here. So you see how small it is? That's not really too much of a problem for us. If, as I up-res it, it's not going to be as high fidelity, but I'm not really interested in the kind of just translating it directly from the screenshot. It's just purely reference that I can take in here, and I can start to sketch on top. You can just straight up trace at this point, or you can have this maybe off on another screen where you're going to use it as just visual reference and start kind of sketching on your own, especially if you want to be practicing observational drawing like that. That's a really good way of doing it. For me, again, to just save some time, I'm just going to kind of drop down the opacity in there. And then I can start kind of just laying in some line work over top to get it to a point where it feels pretty good for me in there. So situate her in the middle there. Just start another layer and grab the old Cintiq stylus and start to get into some drawing on top. So it's going to be good to pick a brush that works well for you. I mean, there's thousands upon thousands of free brushes on the internet. I can tend to use just a simple Photoshop tapered brush for line work. If you feel like you want something a little bit more kind of media like, you can go find some interesting brushes out there. I'm going to stick to just a simple line. We don't need to overcomplicate it necessarily. Okay, so another just tip, lock your reference. You don't want that to be something that you accidentally start drawing into, and you know, you maybe go so far that you have to bring it back in because you've ruined the artwork, or you've passed all of your history states, so you can't just edit undo all the way back to the start. I just tend to lock that so I don't accidentally move layers and start drawing in on that. So we've got our nice pose in here, and I could just start kind of roughly sketching on top some of those volumes, right? For me, I'm going to be changing quite a bit of the parts of the body, making her feel more zombie-like with some of the kind of degradation of body parts and whatnot, so that she feels like maybe she's been a deadite for a while, right? So just kind of getting in there, sketching those areas, getting the look of that face, her mouth open in there, the nose, not being too beholden to the original details too much. They're just kind of like landmarks for me at this point. So I'll go in there and kind of start sketching those things out. These landmarks are really good for us to know where we should be going with this stuff, and some of the undulations of the underlying, let's back it up a little bit there, underlying physiology. We get those claw hands coming up here. And when I get into more detail, I may return to the reference to look at, you know, how some of the nuances of, say, the fingertips, what they look like and how they're tilted or twisted in space. But for the most part, I just want to kind of rough this out so I can start having more fun with the development of some of the details of our zombie. So we have a rough pass. I might just hit a few different lines, like the belly button, sort of abductors and the obliques and whatnot, just real quick. Get some of those volumes in there. I turn that off, and we see we've kind of got our rough sketch of our zombie. So at this point, I could just try and use my memory for developing some of the details in the zombie sketch. It's usually going to be better. In fact, I would say, I guarantee you that it's going to be better that you do use reference when you're starting to get in there and work with something that has to come from imagination, because those elements are going to be able to be visual memories, or you'll learn about something and be able to draw from that in your imagination and bring it into something like this. So I do have a reference sheet open with references that I've gathered because I'm going to be working with something inspired by something like The Last of Us, insofar as how their zombies come to exist with fungus and mushroom kind of fruiting bodies, what they're called. I've got a whole bunch of reference of mushrooms and that kind of thing. I'm not going to show them just because, you know, I don't want to show copyrighted material on Twitch, but you would want to be doing that, right? Likewise, if you're going to be emulating something like a game or a film, go and grab, say, zombies from that film or this game, that kind of thing. Have them up there, see what they're doing, right? And then you can move towards that look by continually referencing that stuff. You don't want to be derivative necessarily. You want to look at that reference material, and you want that to be something that that just inspires your direction, right? You want to take those things and make them your own, so to speak. So with that, I mean, at this point, I could do a few different things. If I were strapped for time and I really had to one-off a piece of artwork, I might not do much variation, right? That's usually the saddest state of development, in the industry, because you don't get to test ideas, you don't get to experiment that much. You kind of have to wing it and hope that your imagination of what that could be is the best thing. Because of schedules and time is money, you know, things get compressed a lot for pre-production. So a concept artist doesn't always get a ton of time to iterate, and they have to one off quite a bit. So if you were able to, you know, you would want to allow for some experimentation just in case, right? Your first idea isn't your best idea, which, to be honest, tends to be the case. So if we were to do that here, you know, I might make a copy of her, and I might just kind of scale that down a little bit if I'm going to do some variants of her. And then I can maybe we'll do three in there. Kind of move them down into the middle. So when I would be approaching this, I kind of want to think about, okay, I've got all my different kind of mushrooms. If your client has a better or more specific idea of what they want to be doing with this specific zombie, then you would have to bring that knowledge of the design brief into this, obviously, right? You want this to, you know, answer the design questions that are being posed. But you still have usually some range to play with in there. So for our zombie, I'm thinking that she's maybe a zombie that we would run into in the dark. And so whatever spore or virus or whatever that's created this look maybe helps her see in the darkness. So maybe these growths are like bioluminescent mushrooms at that point. So that's not really indicating a certain shape of mushroom. So I get to play with that a little bit more. We'll get into that. But we probably want it to be something visible and something that's maybe in the front of her body a little bit, at least, so that she can cast light around her. So we'll have that in mind as we go through this. And I am going to look at my reference for different options in there. Some of the things that I'm seeing, let's just kind of go in here. Let's zoom in a little bit. Some of the things that I'm seeing in the reference, so, you know, those typical mushrooms where we're getting the mushroom cap, right? Or if you're looking up underneath the mushroom, you see the mushroom stem come up into the middle, and then you get all of the filaments kind of moving to the center of that mushroom. So that's kind of the low-hanging fruit. I would think that's the mushroom that most people would associate, or the shape that most people would associate with mushrooms. So if I were charged with developing a series of iterations for my client, I would probably want to get that out of the way in case, you know, that iconic look, the iconic shape of the mushroom is really what they wanted, right? I don't think it's that exciting because it's a little bit kind of too on the nose or a bit cliche even for like, okay, that's a mushroom, all right. But we can start to kind of maybe play with that a little bit. So the idea that the mushroom kind of grows out of a stem that looks a certain way like that might be a place that I would go. So I might kind of start getting these toadstool elements maybe sprouting up and out of her neck. Maybe there's smaller ones. I'm thinking like enoki mushrooms or something like that would be a good scale change, right? So that not every mushroom is exactly the same size. So that there's a little bit of a hierarchy there of those shapes going from big to small. Might they kind of crawl up into the side of her head, for instance? Maybe. I'm not worrying about details at this point. I'm kind of looking at the overall kind of shapes that that's going to make coming off of her body in that area, right? So maybe I get some of those mushrooms starting to kind of move in that direction. If she's a zombie, I mean, you get into the almost the history of the person that was turned, right? You know, what kind of costume design do we want to go for in there? I mean, you've got to definitely be sensitive of any nudity or anything like that, because a lot of games and films are directed to wider audience and therefore younger people. So you can't actually have that going on. And certainly for Twitch, you can't have that going on. So, but it will depend kind of on who you're building it for. So I might have something where, you know, I could do something where the character looked like they were maybe in an office job and they're, you know, business casual kind of attire, which might be a nice juxtaposition of now this person kind of, you know, their skin and body kind of degrading because of this, you know, zombie fungus that's got them. It's just going to seem like, oh, you know, you're going to start to think about maybe a little bit of the story there. So she might kind of have some sort of blouse on, and there might be kind of tears in it where the other zombies kind of attacked her. We can be very strategic about where we're placing that stuff as well. So use your judgment to kind of think about what that could look like. And we have some shredded fabric down below there. Kind of thinking about that. Maybe if it was kind of like business casual, I get like maybe a pencil skirt or something like that. It's kind of pulling up on over her leg, which would kind of have that fabric span across the body there. And we could get some nice kind of wear and tear on the clothing at that point, right? And have that going on. I mean, would she keep her shoes on? I mean, maybe if they were affixed to her ankle or something like that. We could see that gross. We could have maybe one shoe like being kind of dragged behind her where it's not actually on her foot, right? It's kind of fallen off, and the other foot is maybe completely missing a shoe. I'd say a zombie's not going to care too much about damage to their feet or something like that. So, you know, maybe we'd have some damage down there or some muck, whatever, right? Just wandering through puddles and things like that. Kind of just working that in. Maybe she has a watch on, why not, right? Bracelets. So I can really build a story for her, right? With that design and be thinking about how that's going to come across. The next one over might be somebody that was, you know, at a baseball game, playing, you know, co-ed baseball when the zombies struck, right? And so they're wearing kind of that vibe. You'll see this in certain films, certain games where they do play to that, right? The costume design of the zombie to make it look like there's a mixture of everyday people kind of in the moment that they got hit by this thing. So that might be fun to do in there. Hairstyle. Right. I think if anybody had their hair up, like if this female zombie had their hair in a bun or kind of pulled back or anything, a lot of that's going to be tussled and pulled out of that. Right. So you can kind of have that vibe if you want. I'd probably have that hair be something that's kind of really loose in there. And maybe the mushrooms are starting to kind of push up through the hair and grow in and amongst that, which might be cool. Right. And so, yeah, with this one, you know, we're not getting too crazy with some of the way we're changing the overall silhouette. We're kind of filling in the space that we would have over here, right? That negative space. So that's food for thought. I mean, maybe we could even swing out onto this side and get some of the growths coming off of that open part of a midriff. That might be interesting. Okay. Anywhere else that might make it feel believable, right? So the legs would be an exposed element where we would see those fungus come out in there. So fairly quickly, we kind of start building that look on top of our character there, with these kind of almost like shingles or plates of mushroom coming off of her, right? It hasn't really affected her so much where, you know, you get a lot of the body, say, splitting apart. You'll see that in films like Annihilation, which wasn't really about zombies necessarily, but you have the kind of this fungus that splits the person apart, right? And then also in in something like The Last of Us, where they have it start to affect the body physiology by kind of, you know, the bilateral symmetry starts to kind of almost blossom out into a flower or a fungus in that case. So that might be somewhere that I would go next with this, is trying to have some more impact, some more kind of heavy impact on the form of the body overall. So we can kind of decide where that would happen. I mean, it might be interesting to actually start to kind of branch the legs out. So maybe the things start to kind of grow out of the body that way and start to kind of really break the body apart there. We might have something where I decide to even change some of the face elements. So let's actually go back and select that part of the body there. And I'm just going to rotate that a bit outward. Kind of try and position the neck where it should be, the edges of the neck, so that we don't, we're not just making, I'm not just taking that thing and pulling it sideways. So it looks like we've just kind of opened the space up. It just more that the head is starting to kind of bloom, let's say. And so let's deselect that. I do want to stay away from the work at this point. I talk about that a lot in the course of with thumbnailing. You don't want to get trapped in too much detail up close. But so I'm going to keep myself away from it a little bit. And then I might start to get, you know, whatever shapes continually looking back at my reference. See what kind of interesting shapes I can get. Maybe I look at something like a lobster mushroom. And I get those things kind of starting to separate out the face in there. Thinking about the difference. Maybe one of the eyes is kind of taking over at that point. You might get these kind of little weird globules, or almost like these little kind of nodes that come off of her, kind of almost like reaching around for something to grab onto, almost like maybe like a crawling vine or something. Might turn some of these shapes into those more rounded teardrop forms. See that that's kind of being affected in there. It might be fun to kind of open up the rib cage there. In the pelvis. Whenever these things are really starting to kind of pull and reach out in there. I would be cognizant of where I'm placing these things, because a habit is with a lot of people, certainly myself, to be trying to be chaotic about where these things are happening, still have a sense of design, but sometimes it will just lead to areas where it looks like I'm kind of polka dot patterning where these things are happening through the body, right? So that humans will see patterns in anything. Things that don't have patterns, right? So we'll be looking for it. So if it starts to accidentally happen, I will try and find ways to kind of curb that, right? That might mean kind of moving some of the damage around in the body a little bit here and there. So, you know, just be aware of it. Take a minute, kind of take a step back or zoom out in the piece and see how that looks. And then you can kind of continue on if you feel good about it. So one of these arms might be nice to kind of split one of the bones out of the arm, and then have those girls look like it's like they're the reason why. Cool. So that's feeling pretty interesting. Maybe one of the legs starts to become really heavy and kind of heavy and infected almost, right? stepping forward with that. You could get to a point, I suppose, with the design where you kind of don't even recognize the human figure anymore. I mean, that's something you'd probably want to talk to your client about at that point, if you're your own client. Just decide if that's the expression you want to express. And if not, you know, just leave some areas where there are some recognizable elements, right? So that we know it's an originally human female form in there. So you know, that's kind of like a nice rough pass. When you're doing this stuff for your client, you're not necessarily always going to be like, whatever you drew in your sketch, your thumbnail is final, right? You still have time to finesse that a little bit later. What we're kind of testing here is the difference between those options at this point. So I feel pretty good about that as kind of a rough pass on what that could look like. We want to speak to the clothing now. So we could start to get into that. Like, if I'm having these things kind of push off the body and be visible, I can't really have clothing over top of that to be able to see that stuff. So the clothing either has to be not there or torn, right? Or the kind of virus, whatever fungus is kind of pushing through that cloth, right? Or growing, kind of grafting in through the cloth and then out. Super fun stuff. So, you know, let's think of somebody, maybe this character was just wearing kind of like a t-shirt. And so, you know, maybe some of that t-shirt's actually kind of getting consumed by that mass. Some of those lines are a little bit difficult to read. So just trying to kind of simply put those things in there. Have that t-shirt maybe kind of crawl up over top. Right. Maybe she's wearing kind of maybe jeans or something. And then maybe we have the torn part of the jean is where the spores are tearing out of. So maybe some ragged cloth in there. I would imagine if I were to kind of take this to final, I would start to make it feel like wet or something like that. So it feels like there's an actual transition between the body and the cloth. That's not just this weird thing popping out of the side of the body there. And then, you know, maybe the pant leg was pulled up. So this original female character is maybe wearing them as almost kind of like in the summer, kind of like capri pants or something like that, right? Just enough in there. Not everybody has to have watches and wristbands and whatnot. Maybe this character would have some sort of sleeve tattoo or whatever. So, you know, starting to think about maybe not necessarily subcultures, but types of people that would have tattoos on their body, people that would be business casual, that kind of thing, right? Because I'm also, by doing that, we're seeing what our client would prefer, right? Maybe they don't know and they need help in that area, right? So very useful for us to be doing that here as well. Hair-wise, you know, we have a lot of that stuff growing out of the top of the head, so I might have that hair kind of still come out of there. Do I make that messy, right? To make it look like it's been tussled and messed up as she's become the zombie? Sure. Is it different than this haircut? I might want to make it different. Like, this haircut might be that she has longer hair kind of flowing out and around. So yeah, just taking stock on what we've got going on there. We've got one where we've got a minimal kind of affectation. We've got one where it's really kind of affecting her. The third version, I maybe want to change the shape of the fungus, and maybe we ratchet it up even more where you can't even tell that she's that human shape. Or we change some of the kind of physiology or the body type a little bit. Like maybe she's more heavy set, and really kind of maybe that can tie into some of the way we're working with the design of the spores, right? Or the fungus. So I might go with that. I might go with something that's maybe a little bit where the character's heavy set. So that's going to be a good one. I mean, excuse me. The character, the original model that we're using, this one here, is of like an average, maybe an average fit female, right? So you'd have to be doing some work within that to embellish sort of the mass if you were to make somebody like overweight or obese or morbidly obese at that point, right? So you know, if you wanted to do that, you can kind of think about layering mass over top, so just making some of the appendages a little bit thicker in certain areas, you know, like where fat would collect on a human body a little bit more, or even sort of like the arms being a bit heavier set in there. Even kind of like the amount of fat around the face, that kind of thing, and just kind of scale that stuff up a little bit. And then I might go in and just knock back a little bit of the original details in there so that we get that massing. Feeling a little bit more accurate for somebody that is heavier set. Looks like she's got kind of like a Santa Claus beard there. Still want a chin to kind of pull out of that. But we kind of start getting that mass up a little bit there. I think because of the way that mass would hang, there's certain molds, like slime molds, that start to feel more bulbous and saggy even, right? So that might be something really good to work with here, because in the other ones, we have these things that kind of stick up and off the body. Some of them are really kind of sharp shapes like we see in this one up here. We'll just label these ABC. Right. In A, they're kind of a sharper plate looking shape. In B, they're more of like a teardrop shape that seems to move away from the origin of the body. And then so in this one, maybe I have something that hangs down. Right. And that feels more like almost like melting on the body as a kind of mold. So that might be something that we just kind of do in there. And then maybe that takes some of the skin with it, or it starts to feel like it's coming from the skin that way. Right. So. Really interesting molds out there. Sounds weird to say. But yeah. It's something going on like that. Have a lot of fun. If you find this kind of thing fun. I mean, a lot of the principles of the way I'm approaching this can move on to other things. You don't necessarily have to be drawing gross zombies or anything like that. So, but that's, we're trying to create kind of this visceral quality in the designs, right? So just kind of go in through there, figure out those areas. Maybe these little droplets form before the kind of bigger masses start to move off of the body, which could be cool. This one's going to need some pretty good integration with the costume design, I think. I might have to come back to that in a minute to get that looking like it works well. Maybe I go with something that's a little bit more like short hair. And I mean, almost already, I want to start to think about the costume design in here. We've got somebody that looks like they are maybe, you know, comfortable clothes, something visual, business casual, like another person. I mean, you see in films like Zombieland, the clown, right? That's a nice little I mean, it's almost like a trope now in zombie games and films to have a clown zombie. But maybe I wouldn't go to like something like that. Maybe a uniform of sorts. So it could be like a maybe like a waitress or something like that. So we'll just mass is kind of coming out of the belly, I think would raise the shirt a lot, right? To let the kind of belly hang out there a little bit. So that it's very similar to what I did in the in B there, but you know, I think that that would work quite well. So maybe it kind of just bunches up a little bit and then we get some of that detail kind of coming through in there. It could be that she has like sort of, maybe she's like a steakhouse or something. I don't know. Like these stories that play out in your mind are always, you know, interesting to kind of follow through. Maybe she has kind of like a leather apron on or something. Problem with that would be that we wouldn't be able to see much of the interesting stuff underneath, right? You know, like if I were to kind of start to hang an apron over her here, kind of crossing over her body there, then you see the problem with that, right? We don't get enough exposure of the details that might be telling the story of the infection for this zombie. So it might be that I have to kind of switch to a different look. So she might be kind of like, maybe like an esthetician or something like that, with the kind of the, almost like medical scrubs coming off of her. Something collared. That shirt might be buttoned up but bunched like crazy. And then the pants might have kind of like a drawstring, kind of like torn at the bottom. This one I'd probably, I'm gonna have to, if I go forward with it, really kind of have the, let's say, let's call it like a slime mold, come through the fabric at that point, instead of everything being ripped conveniently for the expression of that, right? So maybe it's really kind of bunching up on the shoulders there. Think about where the fabric would bunch up on certain clothing, right? There's nothing better than reference for that, right? Especially if you're not that familiar with how folds work, it's vital to get in there and actually understand that by looking at examples of it, right? So just kind of roughing this stuff out still. I feel like we're getting somewhere with a difference, at least in some of these. She might still have shoes on. Maybe she's got kind of comfy, almost like nurse's shoes or something like that, or Converse even. And so there's some lines crisscrossing around in here, so it's getting a little bit messy. I would clean this up for my client at some point, right? But that might be a nice, or enough, I would say, enough information to really kind of sell what we're after with her. And then if this gets selected by my client or by me, if I'm my own client, then I can go in and tighten up some of that stuff in the next pass. I typically would want to tighten these things up if I'm going to show a client anyway, right? Because it's always good for you, your brand, whether you're in studio or freelance, that the artwork that you show is tightened up, right? So something like that, all these kind of weird things. Maybe it even starts to kind of like grow into her eye a little bit in there. interesting enough. There we go. She's got a shoes on the back foot as well. She managed to keep her shoes on after the zombie apocalypse. Curve of that going through there. Maybe she has a name tag on. So just let's back up and take a look at our options here. So just three, an example of three that we could use for. Hey, Patrick, I can barely see your name. It's just a blue against a dark background. That's why it's hard to read. But yeah, so we've got three options here. Now, could we have 4, 5, 6, 20, right? Absolutely. It would take some time. And of course, as you go further and further, you've kind of used up some of your ideas, right? So it starts to become a little bit more difficult as you move on, but you have to dig deeper and find out what else you can do, right? And that tends to kind of bring up some more interesting options, but also some failure with that, right? Where you're trying things out and they don't really work. So, you know, you take that with a grain of salt because it's a part of the process, but there we go. We kind of went from our original here into some interesting variants, and we'll just drop that one down for us to play with. So at this point, you know, this is when I would show my client, see what they like. Maybe they haven't seen the version that they love yet in the set. And so we might go back to the drawing board at that point, depending on how much time we have, take on that feedback of whatever is not going well in here, whatever they don't like or what they feel is missing, and then hit some more variants after that, right? So for me, you know, I'm going to kind of go through the same thing for myself insofar as, you know, what do I like? Which one do I feel has kind of the most potential there? So I'm kind of liking B for the way some of the body is changing as we kind of build out that whatever fungal virus, whatever you want to call it. I guess it would be a fungus. The other ones are fine for me. You know, this one's very subdued, which is nice, and you could play a lot with just the texture on the skin. C I do like quite a bit. I mean, I'm kind of in between B and C. I think I'm still going to go with B at this point, but some options for us there. I mean, sometimes it's really hard to pick. If I feel at any point that it's, you know, even between two selections, I'll just pick one. I mean, a big thing about being a concept artist is you got to get work done, right? You don't want to be arrested by this choice, right? Analysis paralysis. So yeah, I would just pick one and go forward with it at that point. Hopefully you're inspired by one, or your client's inspired by one specifically, or a set of options within what you've made. But sometimes, the odd time, you just have to go forward. So, okay. So at that point, what would I do? Well, we would take one of these and kind of blow it up so that it's big enough in the frame to actually start working on it in with higher res detail. So I'm just going to take B here, and I'm going to copy that, and I'm going to paste that. Just gonna press shift to scale it up there. I can decide to kind of fit it back down to the original size if I want, but let's just do that for the sake of argument. Somewhere in there. You know, I can borrow some of that perspective line work in there in case I want to add any subtle elements to the base of her. I'm not going to get too much into adding a big background or anything in this design, because it is kind of more about just her in space, right? So, But yeah, I mean, it's just a nice option for you anyway, if you feel like you want to use some of that stuff to build this into an illustration even, right? A mood painting of our zombie character in there. So now that we've got this, we can see we zoom in and some of the line work's really rough. And so it's at this point that I'm going to want to delve into that and start cleaning it up, right? So what I'll do is I'll drop that down again in opacity, start a new layer, and then this is the layer that I can get in there with the detail and start kind of adding any of those more specific elements. I tend to start with the face just because, you know, if I ran out of time, at least, you know, the one of the primary focal points is going to have had its fair share of attention. So this might be a good time to pull that. I'm going to make a copy of that just so I can pull it to the side and leave the original where it was. Oops, and we'll unlock that. And then off to the side here, just so we can kind of take a look at what was going on. I suppose you could get in on top and kind of trace into that, but I like to kind of just look at some of the reference and use observational drawing skills and rework some of the elements. Like I can change her nose shape and her eyes and stuff without kind of starting to get muddled with the background element in there. So we'll do that. I might just move her a little bit further off frame. And then I'm going to erase the stuff over here. So I can get my clear, clean line look going on. Okay. Deselect in there. Put on the old spectacles for some of the detailing. Okay. So I'm just gonna kind of start kind of developing that nose in there, some of that eye shape. It's almost like that angry expression on the eye in there. We initially kind of closed that eye on that side, but I mean, that was me just kind of spitballing ideas. If I want to open that back up, it's up to me, right? In this case, kind of come down in here and sketch some of that jaw really kind of stretching open. Thinking about kind of the way the fungus has opened up the cranium there. I have to kind of make space for it, right? So that other eye over on this side with that fungus kind of moving up in there. Maybe it starts to kind of almost split down the side of the cheek where the mouth is open. Down into the sternocleidomastoids. I'm usually annoying my students with making sure that they add believable transitions between things. It's really easy to just slap things on top of each other, like, you know, plugging things in like a Mr. Potato Head. Right. I'd rather show, say, the skin subtly changing into this transformation of this fungus, right, than just having that overlap and not show anybody how that's actually going to happen. And so it's at the stage where we can start to do some of that stuff. Start working with some of the hair. I want some of that to feel like it's really kind of messy coming off of the head. So not every hair should be in perfect place. I want to make her feel like everything's been disrupted. jaw a little bit more. Looking for some clear overlaps in here, at least in this part of the drawing phase, so that we can tell that those two portions of the head are separate. Something like that. Relying heavily on that overlap, because that plate that's coming up out of the skull there is starting to kind of, you know, those shapes are starting to compound against one another. So if I don't make clear overlaps there, it's going to start to be confusing to look at. So I'll definitely have to keep an eye on that to make sure that those things are more clear, and it may take some extra efforts in that space to make that happen, right? So I'll lay out a first pass of it at this point, and I might need to come back, but I don't want to kind of spend too much time in one area. I want to kind of get everybody dealt with in terms of the regions of the body. So things look good. And there, have that span out this way, and then maybe just disappear up and behind that. So where I can add some interesting contours to the shapes that are traveling down into that crevasse. I do want to avoid any tangents. Tangents being kind of any lines, for instance, that will slowly intersect and then not be a clear overlap. So in a two-dimensional format like this, it's very hard to understand depth when that happens, right? It happens a lot in the real world. Obviously, you'll have edges meet up with other edges, but say a photographer is going to move their camera around or move the model around or the subject matter if they can, to be able to avoid those things, because they're still going to be dealing with a two-dimensional format, and the viewer is going to have a hard time potentially discerning what's going on, right? So if we're drawing things, we can make sure that that doesn't happen. It'll still happen when I'm kind of going through and painting stuff, and maybe my attention slips and I get one of those, but I will go through again and again just to look for those problematic areas and fix them if I can. There's no reason why I wouldn't be able to fix them, so I would just end up fixing them. So we'll get some of that stuff in there. Strong edges on this side. Recent updates in Photoshop have provided some nice little problems with some of the line weight. Still waiting for Photoshop to patch it, but I'm not quite sure if it's just my computer, because it's been years of this happening. So if you're also having those struggles, you're not alone. It's quite frustrating. But nothing we can't hack here. Some of that hair kind of coming down up into that shoulder. That's when we can start maybe having some of these spores really pull out of the skin, maybe almost like beading water. That's how they start. And then you get that massing kind of popping up over top. Your coolerus isn't working. Mine should be working. I haven't checked. I actually rolled back my version of Photoshop, because I was having so many problems with the newest version. So my coolerus seems to be working pretty well. So it might be a solve for you there. to roll it back. So maybe that works for you. So the fabric, maybe this is where I start kind of dealing with the way the fabric is going to be almost like my t-shirt. If something was growing up underneath and then it kind of just soaked through the fabric and then the kind of spores continue to grow up over top, maybe I kind of have some of that fabric lifting up in a way because the mass under the shirt and then the mass pulling out. That could be pretty cool. As cool as all this gross stuff can be, right? But that's just it, right? It is, it doesn't have to be a zombie, right? It can be anything that you're designing, but I'm thinking about a cause and effect for why these things look that way so that I can try and imbue the artwork with that so that the viewer gets that, right? In the storytelling. It's not always that easy just wanting to do it. You know, sometimes it's just really hard to achieve that depending on what you're building. But that would be sort of what I'm after there. So maybe I kind of start indicating a little bit of like a staining pattern on the shirt in there. Kind of thing. Some folds up in here. Some more of that form of the body kind of opening up in there. Right. Some bicep down in there. Does she have big long nails? Maybe she does. Maybe she got a hold of somebody and or fell in the mud or something, and we got kind of like stains running up her arm. Depending on how gory you want to get. We'll try and keep it PG for Twitch's sake. So we don't get in trouble. I mean that kind of just highlights just the different context in which you'll be working. Sometimes, you know, you'll make a zombie game. Or you'll be making on a team that's making a zombie game that is kind of more geared towards kids. Like something like Plants vs. Zombies, it's not going to be viscerally disgusting, right? Whereas a game like The Last of Us would want to be more realistic in how horrible it is, right? So, you know, you would definitely, if you're making stuff for kids, I mean, I would stay away from what we're doing here. Because it just will not be appropriate, right? Or young adults might, you know, be okay with it. But, you know, if you're working on something for young kids, then probably not. With the folds, I don't want to kind of go crazy right now. Folds can kind of get a bit unruly. Putting too many lines in an area, you can get by with less lines and still make it feel like folded fabric. Plants vs. Zombie in a Doom style. Yeah, I'd play that. With the, it's almost like the little Doom guy that you pick up in the game, where he fist bumps the little toy. That would be a cool little version of it. I think it'd probably sell pretty well, especially if you have cute little demons and whatnot. So, I mean, that's something we'd have to think about right here is, in the spirit of something like a visceral zombie game, say like The Last of Us, I would probably start to get into, detailing some of the organs inside here. If I had to pull up on that a little bit, we could just have this layer of this layer of spores be almost like another layer of skin that's encasing her, and then just have her underlying kind of body structure underneath that. I might have sort of like the DNA starting to shift a little bit, and we're starting to get kind of strange looking massing of stuff in there that's maybe a little bit nondescript. So we're not being too gross with it. Again, for Twitch's sake. I'm just gonna watch out. The old Twitch. I get that iliac crest of the pelvis, right? That's kind of moving up in this direction, in this ridgeline here. The bone, we've kind of opened up the cranium a bit, but maybe I wouldn't want that to be everywhere. And then that way we can have the genes kind of wrap around something. In that case. So just to go back to, we're looking at the Daz Studio pose on our right hand side. The reason why I would use this, even if I, you know, we all have to practice life drawing, would be if I were strapped for time and I needed to spend a lot more time doing exactly what I'm doing now, is like the detailing part of it. A posing program that you can just grab a screenshot from is invaluable for that reason, right? That you can kind of get in there and just get that done so that you can spend a lot more time in the other areas. A lot of people don't care in the industry how you come to the artwork, but you don't want to be shortchanging yourself in terms of learning, right? Especially as a junior or novice artist and just using visual aids all the time and not really knowing how to approach drawing the body on your own, right? That can be pretty detrimental. So I'd still say, you know, use it when it's appropriate to use it, but, you know, still get in there and do your hours and get your mileage on life drawing, because it, you know, if you can do this stuff faster and faster, you're going to allow for yourself to be a little bit more agile with client work, right? And not have to always make sure that Daz is installed on, say, a work PC or whatever, right? It's free software, so most of the time in a studio situation you're going to be okay with asking for it to be installed, but hopefully we get the point there. Come down into this arm here. Maybe have these little things kind of poking up out of the wrists. It's like they're trying to get sunlight or water, something like that. Strange little shapes in there. I'm not totally convinced by that, but I'll let it simmer for a little bit. That's another thing, you know, you got to watch out for when you're painting and drawing these things, especially when I was a junior. I get pretty stressed out, sweaty over something that wasn't working out, and I kind of just continue to hammer it and hammer it and hammer it and hammer it and waste time on it, right? Sometimes it's good to just leave it and come back, and then you're not kind of muddling in one area too much. And when you come back, maybe you have some fresh eyes on it, and you may just decide to kind of wipe it out and try it again. I'm probably going to end up doing that there, but I just wanted to kind of get that going on enough where we can see those things coming together and part of the body. What I want is it to kind of feel like it's kind of tearing open and these things kind of coming out. But we'll see how it goes. Pockets in the jeans, the binding of the jean fabric, right? Creating ripples. Thinking about where the seam on jeans connect, where the pockets are on jeans, right? I've drawn enough in my day to be able to imagine it. I'll kind of move that one out a little bit more. But if you don't remember, use reference, right? It's always, always good to use reference. So you'll see me bounce around a lot in certain areas. I do endeavor to make sure that I get solid passes done on the full character before I get into too much crazy detail in one area or another. But sometimes, you know, you get caught up. Just if that's the case, just, you know, move along. So you kind of come down in here and get some of the stuff roughed out. Just looking for the folds in the pants. Looks horrible in a good way. Why, thank you. Yeah, I mean, that's hopefully the idea, right? Like, you'd want this character to be repulsive and frightening, right? In a game or a film that's like, say, The Last of Us or 28 Days Later. 28 Days Later was an interesting one because it was sort of just like the rot of the person, but they had the kind of blood red eyes and like the kind of black bloodish quality around, you know, anything that's been there a while. And they would run fast, and that was the scary part of it, right? Like the terrifying eyes. We could still have that. You'll notice that in a game like The Last of Us, they did still go for that look. A personal favorite of mine is Army of Darkness, Evil Dead. And those are cartoon demons, like zombie demon things, where it's like the eyes are really kind of glowing. I mean, that does move, I guess, more into the demonic end of things, but those people are dead, right? And so they're deadites, so they're kind of zombies in and of themselves. So you can take some cues from films that you like and kind of put those things in there, which is super fun, if you're into that. You know, some people do not like this stuff. So, like I said, if we're drawing kind of fantasy characters or creatures, then we can kind of still apply some of these principles. Clickers weren't too scary because they couldn't see you, but the runners. Yeah, the runners. Similarly in, what is that game called? Dead Daylight. The free running game. What was that called? Deadlight? Dead? Somebody help me out here. Oh man, they're coming out with a sequel to it. Anyway, this game by when dusk would hit, you'd get the call on the radio to like get back. Dying Light, thank you, Patrick. Dying Light, you know, you get the call at dusk, and you'd hear in the distance all of the like super violent fast zombies screaming as they wake up, right? And they come running, or you'd hear that when you trigger something in the daylight and they'd come running after you. It's like, I love that game for that. I forgot what I was talking about there. The clickers. So yeah, the clickers were interesting because they were sort of like an area of effect trap that would chase you, right? So it's like, you just got to be careful here. Otherwise it's going to get you. And then they'd sometimes be roaming around, which was an interesting challenge. I think they had a nice range in there. That's what I really liked about that game, is it wasn't just one zombie type, right? That they were being creative with the differences. I mean, a game like Left 4 Dead and Left 4 Dead 2, they had the classes of zombies, the witch, the boomer, the smoker, and the jumper, whatever he was called. So you kind of had to, you know, the gameplay there was a lot more varied, I think. But I still think they did a really good job of trying to vary enough of the Last of Us to make it feel less cartoony, because something like Left 4 Dead felt fairly cartoony, especially with the tank being as big as he was, right? Anyway. So just gonna spend a little bit more time in these areas before we wrap things up for today, but I will be back next week to continue to work on this leading up to the old release of Last of Us. I'm super excited for The Last of Us as well. It's one of my favorite games all time, so excited to dust off the old PS4. I have not had much time to play the PS4 recently, but I will definitely get that going. Probably be one of the last games I play on that console, to be honest. I used to have way more time, but it's just not as much time, and also kind of PC gaming is just a little bit easier for me to do. And I mean, big epic stories that are hours long. Like I bought the most recent remaster or remake, I guess, of Final Fantasy, and it's I didn't even get out of the first level yet. It's just that I haven't had the desire to kind of delve in for that many hours yet. Still want to get into it, but Last of Us is something I enjoy enough that I think I'll make some time for it. But that's just it, right? Do you play a lot of those games, or do you kind of work on your own stuff, right? Games don't really lead to much. I mean, I say that on Twitch, I'm gonna get kicked off of here, but no, I mean, like it's they're fun and they're entertaining and they're a great kind of release of tension and, you know, good escape, but you know, there's only so many hours in a day as well, right? So if you want to really kind of start delving into skill development and that kind of thing, it's like, you know, where do you spend your time? It's a tough one. It is a tough one. Get this going in here. The tear in the jeans. I feel like these masses should feel like they're coming off of the leg a little bit more instead of just kind of pushing off. So I can kind of imagine this being almost like swollen off of the leg. And then maybe I have the jeans torn around that, right? That swell, or at least the contour of the leg kind of moves up and over that in a way. So that'll definitely be something that I'll, when I continue this next week, I'll have to kind of work on a little bit. The kind of binding of it might be pretty cool, like the flesh is pushing up through it. And then when I get to color, I can start to get some staining pattern in there to make it really feel like it's meshing through, which would be cool. Divinity. Yeah. I think I bought that game and I was like, nope, this is a way over my head in terms of how many hours I'm willing to learn, spend on that stuff. I have friends that love that game. It looks pretty cool. There's a new one coming out as well. What is that? I don't know if it's by the Divinity guys, but it's Baldur's Gate, right? New Baldur's Gate. That looks pretty cool as well. So keep some of the outside of that leg in there. I don't want to kind of mash that up too much. I want to keep some of that going on. Actually pretty excited for the render of this because we can start to kind of make it look pretty cool with some of the textures we get in on those elements in there. I make it look easy. Well, I've been doing this for a while, right? It's definitely, I'll give her a shoe here. It's definitely still like, you know, I there are areas that, you know, I spend more time on, you know, there's always areas for an artist that they need to work on in terms of the quality that they're producing. But yeah, I mean, it is a case of, you know, you do enough repetition of something. Certainly for me, I've worked on a lot of zombie stuff. So it's almost second nature to me now. But it's just mileage at that point. Get better by doing. Maybe she's got some of the flesh stripped off of the fingers there. We just get the bones, which might be cool. So, just kind of pop in a few last details there. There's still plenty of detailing to be done in here, but I think just overall looking at it, let's get rid of the tangent example and our element in the background there and our background element there. And And there we have it. I mean, I might even drop another version. So we just darken that line work a bit. So we went from working out just a pose very quickly in Dad Studio, just to kind of set the mood, be able to gain some time to be working more on the details. And this is what we came to after working through some options for ourselves. So that's one of the biggest things, right? Is making sure that you're not just one-offing everything that you do. Tends to be what happens when you're coming out of grade school, where the teacher's like, do the thing. You take a stab at it. That's good enough, right? In commercial art, you really need to kind of collaborate with your client. And so you don't want to be one-offing things in that regard, because very unlikely you're just going to be tying into their wavelength of aesthetics right out of the gate, right? So very important for that. But here we go. We've got our pass at our inspired zombie. And so we'll come back to this next week and continue on some of the detailing, some of the rendering, getting some value, some lighting in there, texturing that, and then pushing towards a polished piece. Okay. So, yeah, thanks for showing up to the stream. Much appreciated. And, you know, we'll see you maybe next time to continue on the piece. So until then, stay safe. We'll see you guys. Thanks, Patrick.